in our expert guests, Mikhail Minakov. Yes. Why it looks now as though the state has acted against Kolomoyskyi, removed him from his position, and he hasn't made a fuss. He's gone quietly. But is that really what's going on?
Well, his action and the reaction of the entire group, private group, to control their assets, to control the state-run, state-owned companies, as they did for many years already, they used legal, public, and military forces, basically. But in the end, there was such a huge pressure, including Ukrainian society, including State Department, including Biden, so that Kolomoyskyi and his partners simply couldn't resist. Basically, this first attempt and the public use of force, this show with armed people, sending the message that he is not, he's over the law or what, well, it all brought the situation to the point when president simply could not leave it as is. You remember that the first reaction of Poroshenko was just to issue Dohana, whatever it means.
It kind of a complaint, or like, what a boss say that you acted wrong?
Exactly. And it's only in the course of the week, several night-long talks with involvement of Washington, D.C., this conflict came to a situation when both Bogolyubov and Kolomoyskyi came on terms that probably Kolomoyskyi should leave this official position. As Kolomoyskyi later stated himself, there was also a conflict between Kolomoyskyi politician and Kolomoyskyi oligarch or businessman. So this removal from official position of Kolomoyskyi has actually resolved the situation for some time.
But what was the what was talked about in those late-night meetings there? Because it looks, isn't it much less really of a defeat for Kolomoyskyi than it maybe looks like? Or is this something Ukraine really can be celebrating as a step forward in the battle to reduce oligarchs' influence?
No, I don't think we witness the de-oligarchization. Oligarchy is a system. It's based on monopolies, and it's based on access of oligarchs to public posts in politics. So basically what we see today is that one, probably the biggest oligarchic group, should step down and create a certain balance with other oligarchic groups rather than, you know, entire de-oligarchization.
Still, I'm going on because this conflict, it started in a different way. It was not really a rivalry between the president and the oligarchs or the particular forces, but it started with some younger MPs, which started to dig, and then it went so big that nobody could really take a, you know, stay silent, even the government. So do you really think that something has changed, and in a way that there is a way to influence this political group? Because if you really look in that, it was something can influence on the oligarchs.
Well,
what is that?
It's been a very important step that sent a message to oligarchs. Okay, guys, a year after revolution, you should really try to be less visible, less blunt in taking over the government. But you should include, well, take care about the rest of population. At least try to remember that it was a revolution of dignity. So try to not show off. But I do not see any legal or political systemic steps that would prevent oligarchs from continuing their practices.
We have here also Vitaly, who is a partner of Energy and Project, CMS, Cameron McKinnon Law Firm, a lawyer specialized in oil and gas. And this conflict is so much about the ownership of the state oil companies, Ukrnafta and Transnafta. What is their fate? What will really change? Go.
Recently the parliament has passed the law which brings the quorum for the shareholders meeting in joint stock companies down to 50%. And so that means that the state, which owns more than 50% of the shares in Ukrnafta, will be able to convene the meetings of the general shareholder meetings even without the other shareholder, even without the minority shareholders in Ukrnafta. Mostly for the state, that means, and the state is really after two things in Ukrnafta, and that is dividends in the first place, and I think in the second place that would be the natural gas, which is, though Ukrnafta is oil and gas, Ukrnafta is mostly the oil-producing company. There's also some significant amounts of gas or volumes of gas that it produces. So with this law, the government will be able to at least make a decision on payment of dividends. While before, the minority shareholders were just not showing up, and therefore the meetings were not valid.
And does Ukrnafta have any valid excuse for not paying those dividends?
Well, again, there's only something that you can read in the media about it, but apparently the minority shareholders in Ukrnafta, the investors, they claim that they were not allowed to maximize their profit, and obviously they claim that they made investments into the company. And the way how they were not allowed to take some profits out of the company is because Ukrnafta by law is obliged to sell the gas and then to and oil. The gas it is required to sell at the just directly to Naftogaz
for the further supply. Which is the state oil and gas company.
State oil and gas company that Naftogaz will then supply to the population. And the oil, Ukrnafta, and condensate, Ukrnafta is required to sell on auctions, which is basically should be a public thing where everybody can participate, and you know the highest winner wins, the higher bidder wins.
Does that mean it's an industry in which it's impossible to make a profit if you're obliged to sell at undermarket prices in order to provide gas to the population?
That is the claim that I suppose the minority shareholders are making against the government.
But, you know, oil and gas, what is known, is often a murky business, especially here. But with this change, you know, even to the not just to the legal point, is there any chance to... what will be changed? What would be the new management? You know, who are these people? Because the claim of Kolomoisky was also that there would be some, I don't know, Russians coming and things like that. In order to establish the fair system, what should be done? And how realistic is that?
In the fair system in Ukrnafta, I think Ukrnafta has to be brought up to the world standards of corporate governance, meaning OECD standards or something of the like, so that it's transparent. It's transparent how the management is appointed. By the way, you know.
Is it?
No. So the supervisory board, the management board, the auditing committee, etc. So there has to be a consensus, and for the companies to be run efficiently, I do believe that it has to be, you know, a top manager from the private sector. It shouldn't be an official who has no motivation, who has no sometimes experience working in this business, and it is just appointed by the ministry. So I think it really should be transparent and proper corporate governance, and then proper management.
So what else should be done besides what is done with this law?
I think
how to track that? We want to know how to track the success, how to understand.
I think then the shareholders have to convene the meeting. Then they have to appoint basically they will have to adopt the decision to pay the dividends, to reappoint the management, and from there, or maybe change some corporate governance documents, internal documents of Ukrnafta. And but eventually, you know, there are also some things that the minority shareholders can do to the company, and they can still be able to file the claims and you know, protect their rights in the courts. Also, you know, one should not forget that minority rights should also be protected to some extent, and to proper extent, I would say, which is not always the case in Ukraine.
I have a question to Mykhailo also. We talked about Kolomoisky, and probably we will also bring the graph of the most, the richest Ukrainians. Before there were Rinat Akhmetov, the strongest person in Donbas, who was the number one. There is still Dmytro Firtash, who is now in Vienna. And so What is now happening with the Ukrainian oligarchs? What makes it different from the year ago? And how are they influencing the government, being still called oligarchs?
Well, we witness the change of generations in Ukrainian oligarchy. We see that new figures coming up right at the same time that we sit here. We see that new public figures, new figures in the public posts create their own business empires. They take over certain oblasts, certain monopolies in government, so they abuse public posts for the private interest. That's going on, and it's still, there is a group of old oligarchy groups, well established, who are number 10 in the Forbes list that we have recently seen, Forbes Ukraine, like a week ago, they have published their ratings. There are some very strange figures, for example, for Petro Poroshenko, who is number 8 now. There's a considerable drop down in his wealth, and it's not clear for me, is it self-censorship of the group of the Forbes or whatever, but there's definitely new groups coming into the power, old groups being pushed or marginalized, and there's a growing tensions there. The system that was created by Kuchma,
the second president
of Ukraine, the oligarchy, is now being under constant pressure. In that system, president was a dispatcher or coordinator of different oligarchic clans. He created a system of balances, checks and balances. When Kuchma tried to change it, we had Orange Revolution immediately. We got a window of opportunities when citizenry tried to destroy it. We failed. We witnessed once again the reestablishment of oligarchy. We had another attempt of destroying it by Yanukovych, who created a monopoly, who concentrated the power everywhere. And then Euromaidan, was seemingly destroying it.
But is Euromaidan really an opportunity or an attempt to destroy the oligarchy, or is it not also an attempt by some of the oligarchs who were not doing well under Yanukovych to reassert their control?
Well, there's definitely a story, a part of the story, that oligarchs supported Euromaidan because everyone wanted Yanukovych to go. He created too many problems for Ukrainians. But the message of Euromaidan is not about oligarchy, it's about human rights, about political freedom.
About anti-corruption, which
exactly.
In a sense is also about oligarchy, because
Absolutely.
The oligarchs are all accused of exploiting corruption.
Yeah, well, in terms of oligarchs, their interest is to recreate this checks and balances system. They want to still preserve their power. They want to preserve their capital. And in Ukraine, where there's no rule of law so far, they just cannot let it go. If you want to preserve your capital, you have to preserve public posts as well. You have to control government.
I have a question which really could be for Vitaly Radchenko as well, which is almost all of the oligarchs in interviews with the media, they say that they have a strong interest in improving the rule of law in Ukraine, in reducing corruption, in making Ukraine more like a normal European country, as the leaders of Maidan like to say. Is it really true that the oligarchs would like to see that kind of thing happening, or are they just profiting too much from the lack of a rule of law?
Can say what they want or they don't want, but I think the society has changed for good, and you can see that many of them are now becoming more distant from the bodies or from the sectors that they have control. So I think the society is moving the change, not the oligarchs, really. You know, there are some mishaps, obviously. Corruption is not the thing that can be fought or, took over during the night or one day. So it really has to, sometimes the generation has to change in order to fight the corruption to the end. So it's not their process to control, really, but I think we are getting there some day by day, but we are getting there. The Anti-Corruption Bureau is established. There are many initiatives. We're working on the business ombudsman office. There are other there are reform in the state prosecutor's office that that we are witnessing. The courts are taking normal decisions these days, even against the government. You know, that's something that has not been precedented before. We took on the government in the court case and we won. You know, that has not happened before.
And are those things, but financially speaking, are those? Is that kind of progress only coming when there's pressure from society, or is there any truth in the idea that actually it's in the oligarchs' financial business interests as well for things to become more transparent?
I think the financial angle here is being brought by the international financial institutions and Ukraine's donors. There's a lot that World Bank is doing. EBRD has a number of projects that support Ukraine and actually aimed at fighting the corruption. There are many more donors that are willing to invest into transparency and their corporate governance standards and proper laws. Some projects I read about last week that there's some European Commission project to support the Ukrainian MPs to be assisted with drafting the laws, etc. So there's lots of support coming from the donors of Ukraine.
And Mihailo, are the oligarchs now, are they trying to preserve what they have or gain more?
Well, of course, both. Some groups are more ostracized from the power. Well, you mentioned Akhmetov. I would say that today he isn't actually an oligarch. Because oligarch is the businessman who needs, in order to preserve and gain more, needs to control government. I don't see representation today in government or parliament on behalf of
How would you describe President Poroshenko?
Yeah, well, I think it's still oligarchic. He's in an oligarchic position, and there's constant problem for him as a political figure and as a businessman joining the two positions, the two statuses. He should really make a harsh decision and choose for one of these things. Kolomoisky has managed to do so. It's a good example for a president to also follow.
Before to go about how to deal with that, I'd like we show the video from Dnipropetrovsk, because there was a farewell rally for Kolomoisky team in this city on the borderline with the Donetsk region. Some people were a bit concerned how it would look like, and you'll get your feeling.
Мы сделали очень много. Первое, что мы сделали, мы остановили войну и не допустили ее в наш общий дом, как это произошло в Харькове, в Донецке и Луганске. Мы не допустили, чтобы на наших улицах взрывались бомбы, как это происходит сейчас в Харькове и в Одессе. Мы вычистили все банподполье. И всем коллаборантам и предателям нашей Родины мы купили билет в один конец. Пусть они живут там, где им нравится. Или не живут вообще. Мы вооружали батальоны. Мы лечили раненых. Мы спасали пленных. Мы сделали очень многое. Да, мы злые, мы колючие, мы неудобные. И нам пришло время сейчас уйти. Но мы без вас никто. И сегодня я хочу сказать спасибо всем присутствующим здесь.
Was a deputy of Ihor Kolomoisky and the member of parliament. The question is, the people were really concerned, will they protect Dnipropetrovsk again? Would there would be some blackmailing of the government, that there won't be security if they are not there?
Well, that's one of the tools to put a pressure. It's one of the leverages to pressure government. But it's not the only one. Dnipropetrovsk is more or less safe. We have a problematic banking system. And Privat Group controls the biggest systemic, well, the last systemic bank, Privat Bank. So it's probably the harshest tool, the biggest tool of Kolomoyskyi and Bogolyubov to control everything. For Dnipropetrovsk, still, I think there won't be any big difference. So far, Privat Group will control the most of the public posts there. I'm sure that the current governor and the future mayor will be the ones from the group of Privat Group. And of course, we're going to get more or less the same control, but without public figure as a governor.
And do you think that if Kolomoyskyi's interests are sort of further countered by legislation, he's prepared to go further? Isn't it also the case that if he did anything that could destabilize the situation in Dnipropetrovsk or that could destabilize the banking system too much, it could ultimately backfire on him pretty badly because Ukraine is fragile and he needs Ukraine?
Absolutely. Definitely, oligarchs are the citizens of Ukraine. Mm. It's the, still this economic and political system works mainly in their interests. So what we civic activists, academicians trying to do is to reverse to make this system working for us, to make it republic.
So my final question for me would be, so what is the way? You know, because there is a, in order both to fight the oligarchy and keep the country secure, because either they should be, you know, persecution somehow, the courts trying to get their business, something for people feel that oligarchs lose their power, or, but there is a risk for that. Some people say it's okay just to stop it, you know, to draw the line and don't touch them anymore and start from the new, you know, from the white page.
No, well, there's never a white page there. We just have to create, we have already several centers of excellence. We have an active group in parliament that tries to pressure the oligarchs. We have still active civil society. What's next? The next is free economy. And this is where we didn't make our step. We need free economy, and my colleague was right, saying using OECD rules and procedures to control state-owned companies.
I think it's important also to proceed with the reforms, the justice system, the prosecution system, the courts, you know, the police, all of those state segments, state sectors are important, and if they don't change, then you know the life of every person won't change. So I agree that I think the line should be drawn. I'm not a supporter of free reprivatization campaigns or nationalization campaigns, because that at the end will end up, you know, Ukraine will be end up in international courts being sued by some investors at least. So that is not the way. So I think we need to move forward rather than look backwards.
And do you think that, broadly speaking, the events of the last 10 days with Kolomoyskyi and everything can be described as a small step in the right direction, at least in terms of the state establishing the rule of law?
Yes, for me.
I think some reconciliation has been made. And let's see, you know, because the next couple of months or weeks will show how the company will be working, whether that will be an effective way or management or, you know, the fight will continue. I think the couple of next months will show.
Okay, thank you very much, Vitaly Radchenko and Mikhailo Minakov, for a very interesting discussion about Ukraine's relationship with the oligarchs.